This will be our 33rd exposition of the Gospel of John. We'll be in chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. One verse of which is probably the most popular verse of Scripture. When Jesus spoke, he communicated many things. First, everything he said was truth.
Amen.
He'd say things like, "Of a truth I say unto you." Yeah. Or he'd say, "I tell you the truth." Or I say the truth. If I say the truth, why do you not believe me? That's a telling question. And his words, they were given to him from the Father.
Yeah, amen.
He said, "I've not spoken of myself." Mm-hmm. Not doesn't mean about myself. Mm-hmm. Means out of myself. "I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment what I should say."
Yeah, amen.
And what I should speak. Don't think that if Jesus had to be commanded what to say, that you can say what you want.
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, that is ignorance gone to seed.
That's right.
Yeah.
Jesus wouldn't speak if God didn't tell him to say it. He wouldn't say it.
Yeah.
Amen.
You know, we all have had to ask forgiveness for not doing that. Jesus, he also said, "The words I speak unto you are spirit in their life." So they're animating. They have power in them. Mm-hmm. Unless you speak the words of God, your words are just like fall to the ground. They don't really do anything.
Yeah.
See, this is the thing that concerns me about what calls itself Christianity. It has no power. Mm-hmm. Its words don't do anything. Prayers don't mean anything. Messages don't change anything. That's not how Jesus is.
Yeah.
At all. In fact, he said, "If you abide in me..." See, a lot of people talk about abiding in Christ from John 15, but here's something I never hear anybody say this. Mm-hmm. "If ye abide in me my words abide in you." See, they don't say that. You think back about it. If you heard people talk about abiding in Christ, they don't mention that as a rule. "If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will and it shall be done unto you." Now that can't be obsolete because Jesus said, "My words will never pass away." So that cannot have passed away. But the fact that this isn't happening on any measurable scale, that this isn't happening, tells you this is something that's been left out. Christ's words are not even known by great bodies of professing Christians. They don't even know what Jesus said. Maybe you can recall when it started coming home to you what Jesus said, and it was kind of earth-shaking, wasn't it? When you found out what Jesus said, you were, "Whoa, where have I been?" You know. You'll find that all of these things I've said about Christ's words can be connected with what he said to Nicodemus, what he's saying to Nicodemus now in our text. Whenever Jesus spoke, whether he's talking to his disciples or the multitude, no one got the idea that he was just sharing some kind of private opinion. Nobody concluded that, not even his enemies. They didn't conclude that. They knew he was speaking about something that he deemed important and crucial. Mm-hmm. It was not. Jesus never did deal with novelty.
Yeah, that's right.
Or things that are curious. You know, this is the way he talked. Mm-hmm. He's not properly represented by such presentations. This is one reason why people are warned about their words. Mm-hmm. You give an account for your words. Be careful what you say. It's a little song we used to teach little children. Be careful what you say. Mm-hmm. You, mm-hmm. Watch your mouth. Be careful what you say. Good words. Now you want to see Jesus as the as setting the standard for talking. Now that has some, you have to kind of apply that to yourself. But Jesus set the standard for talking.
Yeah.
All right, here's our text for tonight, John 3:16-17. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Amen.
Now this is sort of, verse 16 is one of the most quoted verses spoken by our Lord Jesus, who himself was the Word. And his name is presently the Word of God. See, the reason why it's so well known, that's what handicaps us. Because it's so common and so well known, precious few people actually consider it, what it says. And it's a very profound stain. Now, this statement is made in the context of the new birth. Jesus is talking about the new birth when he makes this statement. But I will tell you that almost 100% of the people that quote this verse are not talking about the new birth. He said that he's been talking about the new birth. He's been talking about the necessity of seeing the kingdom of God and entering the kingdom of God. So this statement connects with those being born again, seeing the kingdom of God, and entering the kingdom of God. You've got to consider it in that context. And notice what it said, for God. So it's a statement about God, and for that reason, we approach it with great sobriety and interest. Anytime there's something about said about God, better perk up.
Amen.
Because we're all going to stand before God.
Yes, amen.
To give an account for the deeds done in the body. Now this chapter refers to the kingdom of God. It refers to God loving in our text, God so loved. It refers to the words of God. In the 34th verse, God giving the Spirit to Jesus without measure, in the 34th verse, and the wrath of God, verse 36. You see, God's at the heart of this. Now it says God so loved. I want to look at those words, so loved. Other versions read, just basic Bible English, had such love. Holman Bible says he loved the world in this way. Apostolic Bible says he thus God loved. Message Bible says this is how much God loved. Amplified Bible says God so greatly loved and dearly prized the world. Now as used in this text, so, that word is taken from a word that means in the manner of. See, he's not talking about just love. He's talking about the manner. The kind of love. The word means in this manner or in this way. So this does not refer to the measure of God's love. Much. That's not what it's talking about. Yeah. See, the verses that say so much, they're just wrong. Yeah. They're just wrong. That's all. That's not what it means. He's not talking about quantitative He's talking about manner or kind.
Yeah, amen.
Kind of love. When reading of the love of God, expressions like how much, so much. When you talk about how much God loves us, so much, that applies more to Jesus than it does to us.
Yeah, yes, amen.
When you talk about how much God loves, that's got to be Jesus you're talking about.
Yeah.
Father loves the Son more than anybody else.
Yes,
make
right.
No mistake about this now. When you're talking about how much, you've got to be talking about Jesus.
Yes.
You talk about us as what kind?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of love? This is what we call a provisional love. It's a love that moved him to do something. He's not talking just about an emotion. I love you.
Yes,
that's not what he's talking about. He's talking about what it moved him to do. It's a great love, as the scriptures say. His great love, wherewith he loved us. By provision, I mean that this happened in the past. The exhibit of this love is not in this text. In this text, the exhibit of this love is not now. The exhibit was in Christ when he died. See, that's what he's... He gave his only begotten Son. That's the exhibit he's talking about. Yes, God's love does exist now towards you. Make no mistake about this, but that's not what this text is about. This text is about a provisional.
One of his epistles, John references this love. He says, "Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called
that's
the
right.
sons of God."
It's a kind of love. See, it's different. See? One calls for thought, the other calls for feeling.
That's right.
See, when you think God loved you so much, you just see that doesn't appeal to the thinking process.
Yeah. Yeah.
That appeals to the feeling process and the emotional process. But here he's talking about the extent to which God demonstrated this in providing. When he says God so loved the world, that's not equivalent to everybody. He's not saying God loved everyone. That's not the same thing as saying God loved everyone. Even though there's a sense in which he did. I understand it, but that's not what he's saying here. The world here refers to the whole race.
Mm-hmm.
To humanity. That's what he's talking about. Now you want to compare this with the angels that fell.
Mm-hmm.
All of the angels that fell as a group were written off. There was no provision made for recovery. Now, comparing man with that, see, that in other words, God's wrath was poured out on them. But this manner of love, it's the kind of love that provides for recovery.
Yeah, amen.
Is the idea. So love does not address his personal attitude toward the individual sinner, although there is personal love. Christ loved me and gave himself for me. There is that, but that's not what he's talking about here.
Mm-hmm.
Love is seen in the provision he graciously made for sinners before they were born.
Mm-hmm.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah.
He is not a present, for it tense-wise, present indicative active. It's not that kind of love. He loved, past tense. And for you to be convinced that he loves you now, you must first be convinced about this love he's talking about. Because his present love for you is based on this love that's exhibited here. Even though man had sinned as a group, just as the fallen angels sinned as a group, God so loved, he wasn't willing to let man go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He so loved. He provided a way to escape the wrath of God. He didn't do it for angels. See, you've got to see this. This is humanity.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone that came from Adam. When Adam sinned, everybody
yes.
was condemned.
Mm-hmm.
That's what Romans 5 says. Everybody was condemned.
Okay.
But he didn't treat them like he did the angels that
right.
fell. Yes.
It's worthy of God. And every love, I don't care who you are or what you're talking about, any love that anyone professes, if it doesn't do something, it's hollow.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
Love always provokes to action. But this love sets God's love apart from every other love.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
Because both in the extent and also the power of it, what it accomplished.
Yeah.
We by our own will, even if we have great affection for something, we're very limited
mm-hmm.
in what we can do. But God made a provision for every soul if they would come to
yes.
Him in faith.
Mm-hmm.
The purchase that He provided in this love is, well, it's worthy for men to seek after and to honor Him for it, and
mm-hmm.
to return
Amen.
That love by His grace. As we're
now, this is accentuated by the fact that the Father loves the Son.
Jesus said this a couple of times. The Father loves the Son, given all things into His hand. Father loves the Son, given all judgment to Him. But when Jesus died, it didn't look like the Father loved the Son. And I'm going to say at that moment, His wrath was upon the Son. This is the manner of loving us. Somebody had to taste the wrath of God. That's the penalty of sin.
Yeah.
Somebody had to taste it.
Uh-huh.
But man couldn't resolve this dilemma.
Yeah. This is because God loves righteousness
yes.
and justice
yeah.
more right. than He loves men.
Uh-huh. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Which accentuates the fault when people try to describe love like God loves me. Even when I'm sinning, He loves me. See, this is so wrong.
Yeah.
Because when sin was on His Son, His wrath was exhibited.
Yeah.
And but see, this soul kind of love, He made a way you don't have to sin.
That's right.
He made a way you can recover from it.
Yeah.
But it's not so you can abide in sin. That's
no.
That's not love.
See, He forsook the Son. Love doesn't forsake.
That's right.
Is it because Jesus could recover? We couldn't. If we had taste of the wrath of God, you'd have never been able to recover from it.
That's right. Yeah.
Like the angels, they haven't been able to recover.
No.
So there's an example of when God turns His back on someone, they can't recover.
That's right.
But when He turned His back on His Son, His Son could and did recover. He came back. From the curse.
Yeah, I was thinking about brought up there about and what you talked a little bit about this idea that God loved man so much
mm-hmm.
that He gave His only begotten Son. If you don't see what you're talking about tonight,
mm-hmm.
in essence, what you're saying is God loves us more.
Mm. Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
And
yeah.
you're not honoring the Son.
Uh-huh.
And if you don't honor the Son, you're not honoring the Father.
Yeah.
You
mm-hmm.
have not seen God rightly unless
yeah.
Christ is preeminent.
Yeah, amen.
Yeah.
yeah.
Remember Paul said, Christ loved me and gave Himself unto me. So if you wonder about the love of the Son,
uh-huh.
He submitted.
Yes, that's right.
He willingly submitted
yes.
to this process.
Amen.
Which confirms His love, too. So there's no question about God's love for humanity or Christ's love for humanity. There's no question about this. So anyone that doesn't come to Christ, see, they've got questions about something that's unquestionable.
Yeah, that's right.
The only reason a person doesn't come to Christ is because they can't see this. But to be saved, you have to see this. The sins of the world were laid on Christ, and God reacted to it just like He did to the angels.
Uh-huh. That's right.
Cast it down, see? He delivered them up.
Mm-hmm.
He gave the powers of darkness a period of time to do their worst.
Yes.
in addition to the wrath of God that was poured out upon him too. God did to him what should have been done to man.
Amen.
That's so love. See, that,
yes,
that's so love. Nobody could ever have thought of such a thing as this. This is beyond.
Yes.
I mean, Job wished there was a go-between, a day's number. He didn't have any idea about what we're talking about.
Yes.
The ancients didn't know about this. This is hid from what God was talking about when he talked about someone coming, see, that would taste death for every man,
yes,
for the whole race, see.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes.
Yes.
A couple thoughts. First of all, the meaning of love has been so perverted. That's the problem with reading this text.
Boy.
Yeah.
Most people think of romantic love.
Yes.
Which actually... Let's say that was true of God. It's not, but let's say it was. Let's say God did have these warm, affectionate feelings for us. As long as we remain in a state of alienation, what difference does that even make? What if God did feel love for us? Here's the example that came to my mind. The parable of the prodigal son. Now, when the son took the father's wealth and was in the far country squandering it, you could say the father still loved his son. Maybe he did. But the problem was is the son was alienated from the father.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So just God having like warm feelings for us, as long as we're in a state of sin and alienation, it really doesn't amount to much.
That's right.
The thing that has to happen is that there has to be some sort of reconciliation.
Mm-hmm.
That has to take place.
That's right.
Amen.
So when people say, well, like Brother Rob was saying, God loves me no matter what I do or something like that. But see, that what that's ignoring is the fact that if you're alienated from God, it doesn't. Mm-hmm. That's really irrelevant.
That's right.
And secondly, I'll just stop there.
Yes. I know what you're saying. Yeah. That's very good.
Yeah.
That's all in this soul love. See, this is a transcendent love. And it includes all forms of legitimate love, but it's transcendent.
Unless this love
provides the recovery, unless it is involved in the recovery, then it doesn't, like Brother Jason said, what good is it? I mean, I'm talking about to somebody who's trapped in sin, who's lost in sin. Yeah. There has to be some kind of a love that can reach you and deliver you from
Amen.
That.
Otherwise, and we have an example in Christ of someone God loved, dearly beloved son, and yet delivered him up.
Yes.
See?
Amen.
But it was at the objective of that. See, yes, Brother Ricky.
Thinking while Brother Jason was talking of that example of that rich man that came to Jesus inquiring about eternal life. And the Bible says that Jesus loved that man.
Yeah.
But he went away having chose his riches over eternal life.
Yeah.
And so that is not the kind of love that is talked about here.
Jesus sorrowed over that.
Or else none of us would be saved.
Amen.
That's exactly right.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the effect of knowing this love, when men see what God's love moved him to do, they comprehend it to some degree. Its calculating effect upon them is quite unlike thinking he loved you personally.
Uh-huh. Yes.
It has a greater... It prompts you to give yourself to him, a living sacrifice. It's a love that provided a way out of the condemned state.
Amen.
That's love now. That's a so great love. God had made men for his own glory. That's Isaiah 43:7. And he refused to abandon that purpose.
Amen. That's right.
So he conceived of this plan that would remedy it.
There was God made man for himself.
Mm-hmm.
Now he did, he had a desire to the work of his hands. It's because of what he had made and what the capacity that was resident in them because of how he created them.
Yeah.
But he will not abide iniquity anywhere or anyone. Now God's love, salvation, provided for God's free expression of love to his children without his love being tainted with iniquity.
Yes,
God,
amen.
No aspect of God is going to be joined to iniquity. And for God to love someone who is iniquitous, so that can't be. God is pure of all of that. Mm-hmm. Whenever he bestowed his love, it had to be toward those who had been made clean and were pure.
Amen.
And sin could not, he couldn't be loving sinners. It says he hates workers of iniquity.
Yeah.
But this retrieved man, those that are in Christ Jesus, so that he can bestow his love upon them. And he himself is not a partaker of their iniquity.
Amen. Mm-hmm. You think of so loved, you think of it as, instead of thinking of it only as a response to the human dilemma, think of it as a response to his eternal purpose.
Yeah, that's right.
Uh-huh. See, think of it that way.
Yeah.
God had an eternal purpose to bring a people, give them to his son as a bride, you know. Mm-hmm. So this was done in the interest primarily of that purpose.
Amen.
Then as you become involved in the purpose, you personally experience this this love. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish. I still like that word, that, in order that.
Yeah.
This is the reason why he gave his only begotten son, so that.
Mm-hmm.
Other verses read, and this is why, so that. This is the reason God gave his only son. The stated effects could not have taken place if Jesus didn't lay down his life and take it up again. Then the stated effects that we're going to read about here couldn't have taken place.
Yeah, that's right.
They solely depended, were dependent upon this soul love being acted out. See, this is why it's so wrong to compromise with sin.
Mm-hmm.
This is why it's so wrong. This inexplicable cost of sin should induce an unwavering hatred of sin in every person that sees that sin could do something like this.
Mm-hmm.
Whosoever, I like that word, whosoever. Some verses read whoever or everyone, anyone. No person who meets the qualifications, he's going to give you some qualifications. No person who meets the qualification will fail to realize the promise. But the stipulation must be met, just as it's stated. It's got to be met. All the distinctions are included. Jew, Gentile, bond, free, male, female. See, that's all of the distinctions within the race. They're all included. Nobody is going to be excluded because they're a Jew. No one's going to be excluded because they're Gentile. No one's excluded because they're a slave, no one because they're a master, no one because they're a Jew, no one because they're a Gentile, no one because they're a man, or no one because they're a woman. It's for the whole race. See, this is for the whole race, without any kind of distinctions. This is because sin leveled the playing field. See, the distinction are just, they're just out with superficial distinctions.
Yeah.
Jew, Gentile, bond free, male, female, they're just superficial distinctions.
Yeah.
When you get down to how God sees things, there isn't any distinction among men by nature. They have all sinned.
Yes, right.
Come short of the glory of God. Now the stipulation is, believeth in him.
Another version say believes. See, believeth is a present indicative active word. It's you're believing. You are in the process of believing. Yes. Believes in him, believeth on him, has faith in him, trusts in him, is believing in him, commits himself to Jesus, who trusts in him, trusting in him, believing in him, and believes in, trusted, and clings to and relies on him. Amplified Bible. As I mentioned, the word believeth or believes is in the present tense in the active mode. It's not in the past tense.
Right.
Even though there was a, we did believed. Uh-huh. But that's speaking about the commencement of believing. Mm-hmm. We believed. We sometimes believed. That began the process. This is speaking of a condition where a person is believing. It's a person is persuaded of the identity of Jesus. A person is trusted in Jesus. A person is relying on Jesus. See, now that's different than looking at it from so many years ago, it's different. Mm-hmm. You may have believed in Christ. I got it in 1940, I think it's 42. But if I wasn't believing now, that voids that back there. At the point you stop believing, or depart from the faith, or deny the faith, that voids any believing you did back there. See, Israel came out of Egypt by faith, that Hebrew says. Egypt crossed the Red Sea by faith. Hebrews 11 says that. But when they disbelieved, that voided.
Yes.
Right.
It voided the faith back there.
Well, I like to say that believing, there is a point at which it is an event.
Uh-huh.
But it's more than an event. It's a process, and it's a personal and continuing involvement. Yeah.
There's no commitment of God to someone who is not believing.
Amen.
Well, there's a commitment, but it's not for good.
Yeah.
Not for good, see?
Right.
He said with many of them he was not well pleased. He saw the ones that believed.
Yes, right. Yes.
The ones that came out.
So if you once believed, you tapped into this promise.
Uh-huh.
But if an evil heart of unbelief enters into you, you're cut off.
Yes.
Now, only God knows when this actually happens, but you are to make sure.
Amen.
Hebrews 3:12 tells you to make sure now an evil heart of unbelief doesn't enter into you.
Amen.
You make sure now. Because
yes.
If it does, it voids.
Yeah.
So when he says, he that believeth in him, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him, is believing in him, is what he means.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Doesn't mean who believed.
Uh-huh.
It's not what it says, and that's not what it means. The word believed, as I mentioned, speaks of when we first believed, which phrase is used in Romans 13:11. See, believing in Christ has to do with you trusting his identity. Believing on Christ has to do with casting the weight of your souls upon him or trusting him. Both of them are involved. Technically, the proper translation of the word is found in the literal translation of the Holy Bible. The word used in is eis, which means it's a preposition that means entrance into. So this literal translation reads, believing into him. So believing is this process that Brother Gene referred to that begins out here and takes you right into Christ. You don't just like believe out here and then remain extraneous to Christ.
Yeah, that's right.
Believing commences when you're out here, but it takes you into Christ. So that's believing into Christ.
Remember, you made a comment a few days ago about the difference between faith and believing, the noun and the verb. It's almost like faith is the end.
Yeah.
And believing is the on.
That's right. That's good. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
The promise that is now articulated by Jesus, God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that, in order that, whosoever, doesn't make any difference, Jew or Greek, bond or free, male or female, doesn't make any difference who it is, young or old, doesn't make any difference. Whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The believing is continual.
Yeah.
God has made no commitment for good to anybody who's not presently believing, trusting, relying on, depending on. See, this cuts the legs off the teaching that says once you're saved, you're always saved.
That's
or decapitates it. This can't be, because once a person quits believing, everything's off.
That's right.
Everything for good.
Everything for good, yeah. The only hope is that he can be brought to believe again.
Yes.
That was the case in 2 Timothy 2, about someone who fell away and a person instructed him so he could recover himself from the snare of the devil.
Yes.
So anyone who's not trusting, and I really don't want to be, as they say, negative. I don't like that word particularly, but anyone who's not trusting, who's turned his attention to men, they're depending on men, or that thing has to be corrected.
Yes, amen.
That person has to stop doing that, and there's grace for this to happen.
Amen.
And start relying on Christ.
Yeah.
This is one of the dangers of always talking about things that have gone wrong.
Yeah.
From disease to whatever.
Yeah.
It's possible to talk about it so much that pretty soon you forget about Christ.
Yeah.
Huh? I've experienced this. You can do this. That's why somebody's got to bring up the main stuff. Someone's got to...
Amen.
I commend those who... This doesn't mean you don't pray for those other things. It doesn't mean that at all. It means that can't be the focus of the attention. That's a side, it's a side type thing. You have to deal with it, I understand, but there's something about talking about difficulties and problems that makes believing hard. So always pepper it, salt and pepper it with some promises. See, the promises articulated is only for those who have believed and continue to believe. In other words, they continue in the faith, as Colossians 1:23. They continue in the faith. Or they, 1 Timothy 6:12, fight the good fight of faith. Or they keep the faith, Revelation 14:2. It's not for those that depart from the faith or make shipwreck of the faith or deny the faith or are overtaken by unbelief. Should not perish. Now, what about those who are believing? This is why Jesus gave his only begotten Son. This is why, this is why Jesus died and rose again. It's why God sent him in the first place to do this. That the race, I'm talking about the race, even though it applies to individuals, I understand it, but in this text, he's talking about humanity.
Yeah, amen.
so that humanity wouldn't be expunged like the angels that fell were. See, yeah, uh-huh. The angels that fell,
that's right.
That's it. Mm-hmm. There wasn't any plan for them. Mm-hmm. Should not perish. Mm-hmm. Perish, it's an interesting word, perish. The concept of perish that's in the Bible is not inherent in any human language. It denotes something that men can't, have never been able to quantify. Technically, it means to ruin or render useless. So perish in Scripture means to be consigned to a state where you, where the person is utterly useless,
yeah, uh-huh.
And has no personal identity. Now this is quite a curse, because man was made to be somebody,
yeah,
and to do something, but to be consigned to a state where you're a nobody and you can't do anything. See the horrors of that.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It's inconceivable. No one can imagine the impact this would have on someone who is made to be somebody, made to do something. That's why man's just not like a vegetable.
Yeah.
Just not something that's used by somebody else.
Yeah.
Man's made to be somebody.
Yeah.
He has a personal identity and to do something in this,
yeah,
particular serve God. But to be consigned to perishing or the lake of fire or everlasting burnings or,
yeah,
damnation or however you want to state it means you are forever a nobody.
Yeah.
You have no friends. You can't do anything that's satisfying. You can be in no way productive. The frustration of that. See, this is one of the frustrations of older age and debilitating illness, is you get to the point where you can't do very much, and it's a frustrating experience. You have to learn to manage this, or otherwise you'll be down in the dumps all the time. Because you are made, see, God made you,
mm-hmm,
to have a significant identity,
mm-hmm,
and to do something productive and satisfying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And as long as you can do that, you can make it through life.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Jesus, God gave his only begotten son so you wouldn't be reduced to that,
mm-hmm,
non-productive state.
Yeah.
But you'll have everlasting life. This is everlasting productivity.
Yeah. Amen.
Everlasting response to God.
Yeah.
Non-ending usefulness.
Yes. Amen.
Just think of it. Here there's times when you're used by God. It's a blessed time.
Uh-huh.
Then maybe there's a period it doesn't seem like you're being used very much. You'll never have this other times.
Amen.
In the world to come. You'll always be used.
Yeah.
Used by God. It involves understanding that brings great benefit,
mm-hmm,
unparalleled satisfaction, increasing knowledge. Everlasting life, now it begins now.
Mm-hmm.
These things, Brother Ricky ministered this to us last Lord's Day. These things I write unto you that you might know,
mm-hmm,
you have eternal life. But
yeah,
you have it only in the beginning.
Hmm.
It's like a bud.
Yeah, right.
You don't have the whole of it yet. But you will,
mm-hmm,
have everlasting life. This is it. This is, you'll have the whole of the thing. You'll have the flower instead of the bud.
Mm-hmm.
Now eternal life is like a tributary,
mm-hmm,
in this world. It's like a tributary of the water of life,
mm-hmm,
that moves in and out among dry and marshy places.
Mm-hmm.
It won't be healed. It's depicted by the great river that Ezekiel saw in Ezekiel 47. Come out, water come out from under the throne, at first his ankle deep, then his knee deep, just up to the loins,
mm-hmm,
and finally it was waters to swim in. That was a picture of life,
yes,
from God. In this world, when you start out, it's just you're like ankle deep. You know you're in there. You know you got it. You know you're in it. But it's just, but as you as you grow in Christ, it gets deeper. It consumes you more.
Yeah.
It affects more of your person.
Amen.
But in the vision of Ezekiel, there were some miry places that the waters couldn't heal.
Mm-hmm.
Couldn't heal them. That's the way it is with eternal life now. There's parts that it doesn't heal.
But those were only minor places.
Well, they're minor places. They're the exception. They will be the exception, yeah. But there's, and that's the same with us. These places, like fleshly lusts, they aren't healed. Huh? They're not healed. Ungodliness and worldly lusts, they aren't healed. The old man, he's not healed. See, there's parts of you that's not absolved.
Yeah.
You've got to learn to live with it and conquer it.
Yeah.
You don't need anybody giving you some kind of mechanical way to conquer it either.
That's right.
This thing can't be conquered by some kind of methodology.
Uh-huh.
It's got to be conquered. Everlasting life's got to be the conquering factor.
Uh-huh.
Now, faith which is given you for our tenure in the present world gloriously triumphs over all of these subsidiary places that are in that. They're minor, but at any given time, one of them can cause havoc at any given time. This is why God gave his only begotten Son. Not to fulfill our worldly ambitions,
but
so we can overcome the world.
Amen.
Have everlasting life.
Remember,
all of this is in the context of the new birth, seeing the kingdom of God, and entering the kingdom of God. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. It is true that Jesus came into the world. In fact, 9 times Jesus said, I came. That is, he volunteered to come. But the Lord is the one who sent him.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus confessed frequently, the Father sent me,
mm-hmm.
told the people this. Peter preached that God sent Jesus, Acts 3:26. Paul wrote that God sent forth his Son, Galatians 4:4. John wrote that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, 1 John 4:9. See? God sent him. The only reason for Jesus is God.
Yeah, amen.
He'd have never come if God didn't send him.
Uh-huh, yes.
The Word would never become flesh if God didn't send him.
Mm-hmm.
It's Jesus' commitment to God that moved him, not his affection for you.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah, you got to see this.
And my Father works.
That's right.
Because he does what the Father does.
Yeah.
Jesus said, I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me.
Yeah, that's it.
He said to his disciples, I came forth from the Father, and I'm coming to the world. Again, I leave the world, and I go to my Father.
Yes, amen.
See, so that's that's how the world affected Jesus. As soon as I finish my work, I'm getting out of here. Well, that's the way I feel. As soon as I'm done working, I'm ready to leave.
Amen.
I don't have any affection to stay here.
That's right. Wouldn't we say that was the joy that was set before
that's
him?
That's right. Amen. Amen.
Can I give it?
Yes.
I was considering that when you come to the Lord, you begin to live your life according to the Lord's will. So if you look at the scripture as Jesus came specifically for me, you're not going to be looking at it as through the way of God for his will.
That's right.
From man's point of view.
When you have that attitude, Sister Annie, that's your proof that you're in Christ.
Because
that's exactly how Christ thought. See?
Amen.
Oh, I must be about my Father's business.
My Father's business. You should have known you'd find me in the temple. Not to condemn. I didn't send to condemn the world. Why not? Because the world was already condemned.
Yeah, uh-huh.
The world didn't need someone to condemn it. It was already condemned.
Yeah, that's right.
When Adam sinned, all men entered into a state of condemnation. That's what Romans 5 said. So condemnation had already been passed on the human race.
Yes.
We didn't need someone to come and condemn us already.
Yeah.
Hmm. And he doesn't save us just out of pity.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Now, God does have pity.
Mm-hmm.
It says of God that he pities them that fear him. So if you don't fear him, man, God, there's no indication God pities you, but he pities them that fear him, but pity couldn't save you.
Yeah.
God couldn't save you with pity.
Yeah, right.
Because pity doesn't address sin. It laments because of sin, but it doesn't address sin.
Yeah.
Jesus addressed sin head on. It's necessary for men to be shown their status, but that's not the finality. You can't leave people with the knowledge they're condemned. That sets them up to hear the gospel.
Amen.
Yeah, amen.
And if they don't know they're condemned, preaching the gospel to them is preliminary. It's not going to be very successful. As one person well said, before you hear the good news, you got to hear the bad news.
That's right.
It's necessary to show men their status, but you've got the most essential thing is to show them the remedy for that condition.
Given?
Yes.
And you have to see your sin before the remedy can be given. You have to see that before you can come to the Lord. That was one thing that I've seen lately is that when you come to the Lord, you've got to see what the sin that you had. That way you can see Christ in a better light. You can see why he made the sacrifice, and it makes it more special and precious to you.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Yes.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
He did not send Christ to condemn the world, but rather. See, Jesus didn't come to calm the political waters.
Yeah.
Or to resolve social issues. Or to make sure marriages were solid. That's not why Jesus came. Jesus can do all of those things, you understand. But not until the sin problem is addressed. So when the church holds out, to sinners resolutions before they're convicted of sin, they have just wasted their time.
Yeah.
God has a message for people that do not feel the weight of sin, and it's not the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
You reason, like Paul did with Felix, you reason with him of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come.
Right.
Righteousness, it means, look, and people had to know this, you've got to be righteous.
Yes.
Amen.
God will not receive an unrighteous person.
Yes.
The unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. You've got to be righteous. And you've got to control yourself.
Yeah.
You must be temperate. This has got to happen.
Yeah.
You can't have continual outbreaks of sin. The lost have to be told this.
Yes.
That's what temperance is.
Yeah.
And judgment to come. You will. You are going to be judged by God. Now, for a person who believes that, takes that message seriously, he'll say, you know, I'm not righteous, but I want to be righteous. All right, now we got a message. We got something to tell you now.
Yeah.
I know I got to control my sin. Now, you could be a Hindu and stop the outbreak of sin.
Yeah.
Don't listen to these people that say I'm addicted to committing sin. This is a lot of hogwash. You could be a Hindu. You could be an agnostic. You could be an atheist.
That's right.
And quit external habits.
Yeah.
So when you, John the Baptist insisted, you got to clean up your life before I baptize you. That yes. The outwardly.
Uh-huh.
The Pharisees had an outwardly impeccable life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, you don't need to have a whole bunch of grace from God to clean up your life.
Yes.
But you do to alter the inside.
Amen.
And the desire.
Yes.
So when you reason with people, look, maybe you've been failing, maybe you say you're struggling, so forth. You got to be temperate now. You got to be. God says you got to be.
Yes.
First of all, I don't know whether I can. Yes, you can.
Amen.
And any person in the world who believes that he can stop this external display, just as surely as that lame man picked up his bed and walked, they'll be able to stop before they come to Christ.
Uh-huh.
But they can't maintain that.
Yeah,
see, that's the catch.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't maintain that, that status.
Yeah.
But Jesus will make sure.
Yeah.
If you're convinced you got to be righteous, and you're convinced you got to be temperate, and you're convinced you're going to be judged, you will seek a means, and God will give you.
Yes.
Give you the means.
Amen.
But as long as you leave people thinking that God's going to be tolerant of their unrighteousness and that he'll wink his eye at their intemperance, you've just left the wrong impression. That is not the case.
That's right. Yes.
In fact, that's your first proof that you're serious about coming to the Lord.
Yeah.
He didn't send him to condemn the world, but that they might be, but through him, they might be saved. Not through a plan, through him. They might be saved. Saved involves, what's that involve? Being saved. Well, it involves deliverance from this present evil world. Galatians 1:4, it involves being delivered from the power of darkness. Colossians 1:13, it involves being cleansed from all sin. 1 John 1:7, purging the conscience from dead works to serve the living God. Hebrews 9:14, being delivered from the wrath to come, 1 Thessalonians 1:10. It also involves being justified from all things, Acts 13:39, being reconciled to God, Romans 5:9 and 10, being called into the fellowship of Christ, 1 Corinthians 1:9, being translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son, Colossians 1:13, being seated with Christ in heavenly places, Ephesians 2:6, being sanctified through the offering of the body of Christ once for all, Hebrews 10:10. Being saved includes being baptized into one body, 1 Corinthians 12:13. Being placed in the body where it pleases Christ, God, 1 Corinthians 12:18. Experiencing the crucifixion of the old man, Romans 6:6. And our body is becoming a temple of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
See, all that's what is involved in being saved.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Being saved doesn't mean you're just forgiven.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
It does mean you're forgiven.
Uh-huh.
But there's a whole lot more that goes into this than that.
Uh-huh.
And let me tell you that no one who is saved is aware of all these things happened at the time they were came into Christ. They didn't know this. This has to be preached.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
You will not conclude this. If this wasn't in the Bible, you'd never know it.
Yeah. That's right.
Cognitively. You might have a kind of a sense of it, but you'd never know it cognitively if this wasn't declared.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are places in the prophets and other places in the Old Covenant Scriptures where the writer or Brother Job or Abraham kind of aspect of it.
That's right.
And they searched diligently to know.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And angels longed to look into these things.
That's right.
And now it's been made known.
Well, it's made known.
What God kept hidden in himself has now been made known.
I think Satan struck a master blow when he managed to hide from the church what happens when you're saved. A lot of God's people were in Christ a long time.
Uh-huh.
before they got a kind of an intelligent view of what actually happened when they were saved.
Yeah.
Behind the scenes, see?
Yes.
Generally, it's associated with not having deviant outward behavior.
Mm-hmm.
But you can stop that before you come to Christ. Yeah. You can't keep it stopped. I understand that. You can't keep it stopped.
Mm-hmm.
But you can stop it. So the person who doesn't believe in Jesus doesn't flee to him for refuge, see?
Uh-huh.
Those in Christ are described as those who fled to Jesus for refuge, to lay hold on the hope. They know where the world's going. It's going into oblivion.
Yeah.
You know, he that believeth not shall be damned. They know this.
Uh-huh.
So then they flee to Jesus. And Jesus says, if you come to me now, I'll not cast you out. It's a guarantee. Now it's a guarantee. If you can come, if you will come, he that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. The fact that this is so unreasonable to multitudes of deprived Christians tells you how successful Satan's been in his delusion. It tells you, this is why we wrestle against principalities and powers, and in our prayers, the powers of Satan have to be neutralized. They can't be neutralized by human strategies.
Amen.
Or just by having a lot of people. That doesn't neutralize. But the prayers of God's people, we got weapons.
Amen.
That can cast down imaginations and every high thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And that 2 Corinthians text is about casting down thoughts that are in other people. Yeah. The church has this power.
Yeah.
God's given it this power. There's an overthrow that can take place of heathen cultures if the church gets close enough to pray effectively.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. And in Asia, just that thing happened in Asia.
Yeah.
So I would say that for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. I would say that it's insanity to reject something like that.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Yes.
This is utter insanity.
That's right.
But no one will accept it and be disappointed.
Amen.
Nobody. Because we're talking about God's intentions here. And God does what he wants.
Yes.
Would any of you have a word you'd like?
Simple thoughts about what we just talked about tonight. They'll come up with things like, they'll say, well, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. But see, that's too simplistic.
Yeah.
You're a lot more than that.
That's
yeah,
right.
You were in sin, but now you've been justified. And, you know, it just, that you don't want to stop there.
Yeah. That's right. Yes, Brother Jonathan.
This love that we went over tonight, it's of such a great magnitude that it's only going to be properly understood when you look at what God has said himself. It can't be understood lexically or by the world's definition.
Mm.
And because people resort to worldly definitions, they actually speak about the love of God like more like an infatuation of some kind.
Yeah.
Which is a cheap version of
uh-huh.
it. Yeah. Because God didn't send his son to die because he was just nuts about you, so to speak. This is part of God's good nature. By grace you're saved. It's in God's nature to save and to show mercy. And so for that sense, we're grateful for it. It wasn't something in us that provoked God. Like we're this attractive thing that God just, a prized possession that God just had to have. That wasn't the motivating factor. I was really appreciative of you emphasizing like his love for his son. That's an important part of this.
Yeah, it's his greatest love is for his son.
Yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
That's the only reason he can love us.
Amen.
Exactly.
Well, I appreciate so much what you've drawn together in this text this evening. These are things that I personally have caught glimpses of.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But not been able to put together in this manner.
Uh-huh.
And I'm grateful to be able to see it.
Amen.
In the first part of your lesson, we were talking about the love of God and the justice of God. I thought about this text that we often refer to in the Psalm, mercy and truth have met together.
Yeah.
Righteousness and peace have kissed each other.
Uh-huh.
And then what you said about the fullness of eternal life, I thought about Aaron's rod that budded.
That's right.
Brought forth buds and bloomed blossoms and yielded almonds.
That's right.
All at once, yeah, at the same time. That doesn't happen on a tree in the earth.
Yeah.
No.
They have them sequentially, one at a time, uh-huh, not all at once.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah, this time spent convincing people of the power of God as much as you're able is time well spent.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yes.
Judah, did you have something?
I appreciated this point that before change, before Jesus changes, there has to be desire to change.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're not going to change, then it doesn't matter what anyone else does. If Jesus doesn't plant that desire in you to start with, then no change is going to be made.
Yeah.
Remember when the priests carrying the tabernacle had to cross the Jordan River, when their feet hit the water,
yeah,
is when the waters parted.
Yeah.
And it was only when that man with the withered hand tried to stretch forth his hand,
that's
like
right,
Jesus told him to, that only then did he get the power to
that's
do it.
Right. Uh-huh.
So if the man hadn't believed this isn't going to happen, then no power would have been
right,
given. The same,
yeah,
same with the lame man, the one where it says his feet and ankle bones received strength.
That's right.
If he hadn't have tried to get up from his bed,
yeah,
and walk,
uh-huh,
then no strength would have been given. So that if there's no, you have to see the need first in order to get the desire. But when the desire is truly there, that's what Jesus can work with.
Yeah. Well, everyone must see this. That,
yeah,
at the point you know what God has asked you to, has asked or commanded, however you want to put it, to do, if you extend yourself to do it, God will empower you to do it.
Mm-hmm.
You'll get it done.
Amen.
But that takes faith, see? Anyone else tonight? All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that you sent him into the world, not to condemn the world, but that through him we might have everlasting life. We thank you for this. We ask for grace to live consistently with this purpose. And we thank you for giving us grace to do so. In Jesus' name, amen.